sold and teach or preach the word of God however we the Lord need her. In Jesus' name. She's a wonderful woman of God. She's a servant. She has a servant heart. She loves Jesus. She loves his ministry. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
You have set it on to do, Lord God. Let every ear that hear that's on the sound of my breath, Lord God, open their eyes that they may see, their ears and their spirits, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, Lord God. In the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Thank you, Pastor Jones, for such a lovely introduction. I want to thank Sister Jones just for being who you are to me in my life. And to every minister and prophet in the house tonight, Lord God, thank you for this word. That I received. I received this word back in October of last year. And I have been holding, didn't know why I was holding on to it for such a time as this. And it was because the last two or three sermons that I've been preached that I realized why the Lord held me on until now. And as I go forth, you'll see why. Okay? We're going to turn to John chapter 11. If I can get a reader, I appreciate it. This is a very familiar passage of scripture. A Bible scholar like myself, you know what we're going to.
John 11.
John 11. We're going to start at verse 30.
John chapter 11 and verse 30 says, "Now Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in that place where Martha met him. The Jews then which were with her in the house and comforted her, when they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out, followed her, saying, she goeth unto the grave to weep there. Then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. And said, where have ye laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. And some of them said, could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus therefore again groaning in himself, coming to the grave. It was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. Jesus said, take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, said unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he have been dead 4 days. Jesus said unto her, said I not unto thee, that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus said unto them, loose him and let him go. Then many of the Jews which came to Mary and had seen the things which Jesus did believed on him. But some of them went their ways to the Pharisees and told them that what the things Jesus had done.
Okay, oh, right there. All right, we're going to focus on verses 38 through 44, okay? Now, like I said, this is very familiar. If you read your Bible, I'm sure if you've been to church any time in your life, you've heard many, many sermons on this very same passage, this very same story. And some of the titles could be, What Has You Found? Loose Him and Let Him Go? Come Forth? I mean, the titles are endless when it comes to the story. Okay? They're endless. Endless. But we're going to flip the script a little bit, okay? We're going to look at it a different way. Look at it from a different perspective, okay? No matter what song you heard, I'm sure it was from God, but we're going to just go dig a little deeper. Dig a little deeper. So we're going to focus on verses 38 to 44. Read 38 again for me.
Jesus therefore again, groaning in himself, coming to the grave, it was a cave, and a stone lay upon it.
Now it was a grave, but it was a cave that was stone to lay upon it. Okay, keep that in mind. All right, come on.
Jesus said, take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, said unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he have been dead 4 days. Jesus said unto her, said I not unto thee, that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me.
This one gonna hang my hand at. The title of the mission is Deal with the Issue.
Amen.
Deal with the issue. Okay? Deal with the issue. And the issue is a vital or unsettled matter. It refers to a challenging situation or something that has happened that needs to be dealt with. It's a concern. It's a problem, in other words. Okay? It's something that but you wanna hide from God. But God said, no longer. No longer. Let Memphis Williams say it. God about to do some exposing in the house tonight. He said, you cannot hide anything from God.
Amen. That's right.
I do not care how where you go, no matter how hard you try.
Yeah.
God knows all, he sees all, he hears all. Where are you gonna go that you're gonna be from God?
Yeah.
Where are you gonna go?
Amen.
Nowhere. He's going to make you deal with the issues that you've been trying to hide or try to bear and try to hide from him. We try to hide from him. But he's got to bring it to light. He's about to expose. Now, I'm going to break right here and I'm going to give a little disclaimer. I'm not talking about you unless I'm talking about you. Okay? So if you're not you, then I'm not talking to you. But if I'm talking to you, then I'm talking to you. All right?
All right. Thanks, Ms. Jones.
All right. Now, I'm not talking about things that you may have hidden from people within your own inner circle or your family, but he said, but I'm talking about things that you're hiding in your heart.
That's right.
That's what we're talking about. Things you hide in your heart. And God says, get rid of it. He said, get rid of it. Confess it. He said, kill it before it kills you. Kill it before it kills you tonight. Because I'm telling you, judgment day is coming. And you're going to stand before God. And what you going to say? What are you going to say? What are you going to say? We had an opportunity many sermons ago, many times, Pastor Jones has made the call to call. And even on this past Sunday, he even said, I feel in my spirit that someone needs to come here and get prayer.
That's right.
Okay. Nobody. Nobody called but you. He even said it. You can't blame nobody but yourself.
That's right.
Nobody but yourself. We're going to look at, turn to Joseph. Joshua, chapter 7. Let me go start at verse 1. we're going to look at how one man's sin messed up a whole nation of people.
But the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed thing. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, and the son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed thing, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel.
All right, go down to verse number 19.
And Joshua said unto Achan, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confessions unto him, and tell me now what thou hast done, hide it not from me. And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done. When I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonian garment, and 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight, then I coveted them and took them. And behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. So Joshua sent messengers, and they ran unto the tent, and behold, it was hid in his tent, and the silver under it. And they took them out of the midst of the tent and brought them unto Joshua and unto all the children of Israel and laid them out before the Lord. And Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan, the son of Zerah, and the silver, and the garment, and the wedge of gold, and his sons, and his daughters, and his oxen, and his asses, and his sheep, and his tent, and all that he had. And they brought them unto the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, why hast thou troubled us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones and burned them with fire after they had stoned them with stones. And they raised over him a heap of stones unto this day. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger. Wherefore the name of that place was called the Valley of Achor until this day.
You see how one man's sin caused his whole family to be perished? All because he covered it what? Some gold, some silver, and a couple of pieces of clothing? I wonder now, was it worth it? Was it worth it? So I'm asking you tonight, is that sin you hiding in your heart, is it worth it to you tonight? Is it worth it to you tonight? He'd be holding on to it. Is it worth it to you tonight? It's gonna cost your soul to go to hell with no reason.
Amen. Help us, Lord.
When you can let it go and let God right now.
Amen. That's right.
You just got to be singing that song. I got a feeling of it. Yes, Lord, in my soul. But somebody, I was lying. You was lying. I'm just telling the truth. You was telling people you wasn't. Mm-mm. No, you don't. No, you was lying.
My God.
You got a yes, Lord, until. But not a yes, Lord, for your whole soul.
Come on.
Come on now. Because of one man's sin, it compromised the wholeness of the entire nation.
Yes.
The incident was serious because of such transgressions, being that he brought the holy name of God and the reputation of God into disrepute. The city of Jericho was under a divine ban. A divine ban, meaning the Lord had already gave them command, told them not to touch anything. But Rahab, and who was all in her house, was the only one that could be kept alive. Everything else had to be gone. But he coveted some silver and some gold and some garments. That meaning that nobody was to be left alive but Rahab and all she had in her house. Turn to Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 23. Yes. Go to 26. Yes.
But the Lord thy God shall deliver them unto thee, and shall destroy them with a mighty destruction, until they be destroyed. And he shall deliver their kings into thine hand, and thou shalt destroy their name from under heaven. There shall no man be able to stand before thee until thou hast destroyed them. The graven images of their God shall be burned with fire. Thou shalt not desire the silver or gold that is on them, nor take it unto thee, lest thou be snared therein. For it is an abomination to the Lord thy God. Neither shalt thou bring an abomination into thine house, lest thou be a cursing like it. But thou shalt utterly detest it, and thou shalt utterly abhor it, for it is a cursed thing.
It is a cursed thing. Now, those are tangible things, things you can touch, things you can put your hands on, or whatever, things you can actually see, like a silver and a gold, bronze, wood, anything like that. God said it's a cursed.
Right.
But today, God is saying, he's telling you, take away the stone and deal with the issue you buried in your heart.
Yes.
Now, anything that's buried or that you are sort of hidden can spring back to life. If you have not purged it, you haven't dealt with it, even got rid of it, you ain't destroyed it by the name of just the blood of Jesus. You have not gotten rid of the name of Jesus. It has the potential to spring back forth to life. God's power is greater than any habit, any hang up, or any can't help it, or in a circumstance that has a stronghold on you. When you repent, and that means to change, you mean you go the opposite of what you were previously doing. I want to use for example tonight. Minister McConnell, come here. Pastor Jones, can I borrow you for a moment too, please? I'm going to show you something. Ms. McConnell, I remember you saying in a testimony one night that you was a street man. You loved being in the streets. You loved doing your little thing with your little boys, with your little homies and stuff like that. You loved running with your homies, am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
You did. You loved that. You loved it. You loved it. You did. You did. You loved it. But what happened?
Okay.
You repented and you changed. Okay. That'll back to him. Now, he loved the streets. He was all up on the streets. Now, you go through. You got to turn him. Hold on to his belt buckle down. Hold on to him. Now, he want to change. But all he did is turn his back to him. Now, you try to get away. Try to get away. All he did was turn his back to him. Some people tell you, oh, you're good now. You confessed the Lord. You've done this, so you're good. You done turned your back to sin. You good. You go on. You go on. You say you're going on to heaven. But the devil still got a hold on. Still got a hold on. You done turned, but you ain't ran. You done turned, but you ain't. That's all you did. It's turned. It's turning your back on it. You can still hear what the devil doing. You can still do it. You can still hear what the devil doing. Am I right?
Amen.
You say you can still feel the beat bopping on the street.
Yeah.
Come on.
Jesus.
I don't care what you do. He still got a hold on you.
Yes.
Oh, well, all you've done is turn your back to it.
Amen.
It don't do that. It don't work like that.
No.
You got to go a little further.
Yes.
But you got to get some zeal in your heart.
Yes.
You got to run with all your might to get away from that devil. When you get that zeal, can't nothing stop. When you make up your mind, can't nothing stop. When you make up your mind, can't nothing hold you back.
Amen.
I would say God's power is greater than any habit.
That's right.
And it can't help it.
That's right.
When you have that stinking thinking,
come on. Yes.
You tell me God can't solve that for you.
Come on.
You gonna trust God to help you with it?
That's right.
Or maybe the problem is, Pastor Jones.
No problem.
They're too embarrassed to come up and get in line. They go up there and pray with me anything.
Come
stay.
On now. Come on, amen.
That's in a nutshell right there. You're too afraid of what people are going to think or what they're going to say.
Yes.
But I'm telling you, if you're going to let what somebody may think or what somebody may say, and when you stand before God, want to get up, I thought this time was gonna talk about me. She was gonna get on and was gonna be praying over me, and I just didn't want to get up and say nothing. So I but Lord, but he said, but I sent a word.
Come on.
I gave you an opportunity. I gave you a space and a time to repent.
Yes, yes.
What are you gonna say? Depart from me.
On,
I know you're
on,
not.
Come on.
And he gonna cast your soul in the
air. Come on.
Some ask you again tonight, is that habit worth it?
Is it worth it?
Is that issue that you're dealing with, is it worth it tonight? Is it worth it?
Amen.
So when you preach, repent, that means you change, you do the opposite, you go the opposite direction. You do things you haven't previously done before. You do a new thing.
That's right.
You do something new.
That's right.
And then you get that zeal in you when you're determined to walk with God no matter what.
That's right.
And you know what? When you do, He'll give you the strength to conquer the issue you're facing.
That's right.
Now, some of y'all like to play with the devil. You do. I see you. Some of y'all even talk to God like you talk with a cereal lesson. You do. You talk to the devil like you talk with a cereal lesson. Then you want to try to bind the devil when you got old, when you get the bad report from the doctor, or you get the bad credit report, or when your bills and your money looking funny, or your change ain't looking strange, or stuff like that. Then you want to try to cast the devil as, oh, devil, get it off my money. Do all this right here. You can't even strain a gnat out of a teaspoon of milk. Now, how are you going to do something with the devil?
Jesus.
But you know what the devil going to do to you? I'm going to tell you. He's going to say, Paul, I know.
Come on,
Jesus,
God.
I know.
Yes.
But who are you?
Come on.
Who are you?
Come on.
Ask the seven sons to see.
Come on.
Go to Acts 19. Verse 11 down to 17.
And God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. Then certain of the vagabond Jews, exorcists, took upon them to call over them which had evil spirits. The name of the Lord Jesus, saying, we adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaching. And there were seven sons of Sceva, a Jew and chief of the priests, which did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? Who are ye? And the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them and overcame them and prevailed against them, so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded. And this was known to all the Jews and Greeks also dwelling at Ephesus, and fear fell on them all, and the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified.
Now, that's some of y'all in here right now. You want to play with the devil like, you know, like you say, you talk with a Siri and Alexa. Like it's a light switch, like he gonna move when you say move. No. Mm-mm. No, ma'am, it don't work like that. You're not dealing with Alexa and Siri. That may be some of their names, but that they're not. These are spirits. These are spirits. The danger of a private war is that unless you struggle, your struggle is brought to light. No one will know you're fighting it. It's a challenge for any believer in the right standing before God to admit that he or she is struggling with a private bondage. Like I said, people are more afraid of what others may think because of what you got up and asked a prayer for. Swallow your pride and cry out and say, Lord, help me. And say, Lord, help me. But like I said, you got to deal with these issues. You got to deal with something. You got to clean some things up on one day. I remember one day I had woke up early in the morning I don't do this very often because of this, what I'm about to tell you. Now, I got to cook me and my cousin some breakfast, and I fixed us some grits and some eggs and some biscuits and stuff like that or whatever. And when we finished eating, I took the grit pot, which you know, it gets a little sticky, and I hate cleaning it. And I was going to let it soak in the sink full of my little water in it. But I hear the Holy Ghost said, deal with it. So I said, Lord, I don't want to clean this up right now. I won't let it soak. He said, no, deal with it. So I ran the sink full of hot water,
yes,
put a little soap in it, put the pot in there, and I began to scrub that pot. I began to clean it, and I got every grit, every granule out of it. He said, that's what the Holy Ghost is doing to
you.
He's cleaning you out. And he'll clean you up if you allow it. If you want to go through the process, you want to trust that process. But some of y'all don't want to go through because you're too embarrassed about it. You don't want to admit that you need to be clean, that you need to be purged, that you need to repent and do something, go maybe do your first fruit up again. You don't want to do it because you're too embarrassed. But you can swallow your pride tonight and come on and come before the Lord. Because I'm telling you, one day you're going to stand before God and it may be too late.
Amen.
It may be too late.
Amen.
But you got to deal with those things that you don't want to face sometimes. And I'm not saying that it's easy. I'm here. I had to be the first partaker of this. It's not easy dealing with things you don't want to deal with. But you got it. Because I'm telling you, I'd rather go and step on my toes right now than even stand before him and he tell me to fall from me. Them were the saddest words I will ever hear in my life. Those will be the saddest words I ever hear in my life. I don't want to do it. We want to maybe hide on it and maybe deal with it later or something like that. But you know, when you sleep under your rug, say, you know, that rug begins to move and it gets a little heel on it. And if you got a little lump there or whatever, that's because you done bury some up under it and you don't want to clean it from under it. You don't want to deal with it. But you never get anywhere in life unless you deal with those issues that you ever have that stronghold on you. You got to deal with it. You got to kill that root. Like I said, kill it before it kills you. So whatever your it is, whatever your it is, deal with it. Don't bury it. Don't bury it. Anything that has buried has potential for growth.
That's right.
Anything that's buried. Now, if you find yourself dealing with the issue, you're not feeling made in your mind that you still got some pride or whatever, so you got this thing in your mind ain't made up. If your mind is not made up, you're not willing to deal with it. And at the heart of it, you got to be willing to give it up. And some people ain't willing to give it up. And that's sad tonight. If you don't deal with the issue, you'll never be able to get out of your full potential. They'll leave your full potential that the Lord has made for your life. There are things that he has meant for you to have your growth. But the devil wants to keep you stunted. As spiritual men, he wants to keep you. And sometimes the devil, he'll bless you to keep you where you are. And you too blinded to know the difference. You think that God had done something and it wasn't from God. It was from the devil himself. Because he wants to keep you right where you are. And that's sad too. Like I said, you got to stop toying with the devil. Stop playing with him. It does no good to do it that way. I'm telling you, it does no good. Trust me. But you got to deal with these issues. I'm going to give you six points. You got to read and you got to study your word. You got to fast and pray. You got to cast down those imaginations and reject the negative thought that comes in your mind. You got to have faith over fear. Abstain from sin and trust God in his process. Because with nothing is impossible with God. Because all things are possible with God. With God, all things are possible. But the moment you get out of his will, I can't help you. Because you don't want to be helped. Sometimes God will use problems to input you. Things like to see what's in you. Like a tea bag in water. He won't see what's going to come out of you. He won't see himself in you. He'll use problems to direct you, get you to moving. When you don't want to move, he'll make you move. He'll grace you for you to move. He'll use problems to correct you. He'll use a problem to protect you and then bless you in disguise. He'll use problems to perfect you, to see what's in your character. To see how much you're more interested in your character than you really than your comfort. He doesn't care about your comfort. It's all about your character. And when you have dealt with the issue, and it's no longer an issue, then and only then you can become sanctified sufficiently. You will be holy and sanctified, set apart, so you become a vessel of honor for use. And once you're sanctified sufficiently, then and only then will you be able to display the fruit of the Spirit. And in the natural and in the spirit, a tree is known by the fruit it bears. You become a tree of righteousness, and not that you determine to what kind of fruit you are. I just never look and tell you, hey, that's a woman of God. And I'm like, who are you? You say you say, but what I'm saying is not what I'm saying.
Right.
I should have to wonder if you say they're not by looking at you.
Right.
And when you've done that, then there can be unity in the church. And when you've done that, we can all be on one accord and we can have all things common. And once we have unity in the church, then and only then can we determine what's on our credit report with God. our credit score will go up because God can trust us again. And once we've established good credit or excellent credit score with God, then and only then can we experience the blessings of Abraham, part one and part two. Because then you realize that only you're coming up.
Wow, right.
But God is about to uncover it. You put a stone over safekeeping. It's not dead, it's buried under the validity, but you got to put away, you got to put it with safekeeping. But God said, roll the stone away and deal with it. If something is dead and buried, there should be no sprouts, no daisies, nothing should be growing. That means something is still alive underneath it. It's still fertile. You still doing things to fertilize it. You watering it. You watching TV. You reading the books. You looking in the magazine. You talking a little too much or something like that. That's what you fertilize and you'll see in the night. So I said, kill it before it kills you. You want to revive the issue for later use, but thinking that you may need it. You can't go back to it. Like it's like, you may want to go back to the streets. No, you can't go back to the streets. You've been bought with a price, son. You can't go back. You can't go back. All you need is God. All you need is the Holy Ghost. And you said, I am that I am. And everything that you need, he's in that I am. If God is not enough for you tonight, I don't know what will be. I don't know what will be if God ain't enough for you tonight. Turn to Revelation 12. This is where I'm going to end.
Revelation
12. I'm going to start at verse 10 and go to verse 12.
And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of the brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night.
Hold it right there now. Imagine this. The devil is going before God day in and day out, night and day, accusing the brethren. So I'm like, what does he have to accuse them of? I mean, you got to be doing something that you ain't got no business of if he got something on you.
Jesus.
Am I right? If he ain't got no place on you, no hold on you, what does he have to go before God on you about?
Amen.
Because he's going there day in and day out, night and day, accusing the brethren. He ain't talking about the people of the world. He already got them. He's accusing the brethren. Come on.
Therefore, rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil has come down unto you having great wrath, because he knoweth that he have but a short time.
I think he just verse 11.
Go back to verse 11.
I'm reading verse 11.
And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives until the death.
Now how they overcome him? How they overcome him?
By the blood of the Lamb and the words of their testimony.
So the blood of Jesus and my testimony?
Yes.
Do you know what that's? The young lady gave a powerful testimony one Sunday. About 3 or 4 Sundays ago, she gave a powerful testimony. She made a confession. And you know what? When she made that confession, she took the devil's fangs out of his mouth.
Yes.
She snatched them right out of his hands.
Wow.
She took all the cards off the table.
Yeah.
Gave him nothing. She had nothing on her no more. Nothing on her anymore. She got free because of her testimony.
Yes.
She was free because of her testimony. That was a very powerful testimony. And that's what the Lord wants y'all to do tonight. Confess that thing. Get rid of it.
That's right.
Get rid of it. And when you do, the devil will have no hold on you. He can't have you get rid of all your playing cards. In other words, you done trumped it. You done flushed it. I'm not a card player without hearing people talking. You done put a flush. You got the ace of ace. You got the ace of all the team. Come on now, you got them all. You done took all his playing cards from him. But some of y'all still want to play with him.
Like you playing patty cake.
Don't. He is out to kill and to destroy you. He can care less about you. He already know where he going.
He knows where the end is. You think he can? He's got nothing to lose.
Amen.
But you do.
Amen.
You got everything to lose.
Yeah.
So is it worth it tonight? Is it worth it? Deal with it. Deal with it. Deal with it.
Amen.
And when you do, like I said, you'll take the hands of him. You'll take any word of that. He won't have no place on you. He won't have no hold on you. Because you won't have nothing. You say, neither have place to the devil.
Amen.
Neither give place to the devil. Ephesians 4, I think it's around 27. Neither give place to the devil. Don't let him have a hold in your life. Don't let him have a hold in your life. Get rid of it. Get rid of it. Do things anew. Back into the hands of God.